Okay, our next presenter is Beth Matarazzo, and Beth feels passionately about how people experience receiving care and treatment and in how nurses take part in and influence this experience through the uniqueness of the nurse-patient relationship. She sounds like a mental health nurse to me. Beth is a credentialed mental health nurse. And is currently working with a small team within the Journey Toward Clinical Excellence project, which is a joint initiative between the Office of the Chief Nursing and Midwifery Officer and the Executive Director of Nursing and Midwifery Services, Metro South. So please welcome Beth. Her presentation is called Clinical Excellence and Love Project, and I'll get her to explain that.
Thank you. It's been a long day. Hi guys. And I think this part of any afternoon was sort of starting to get a bit scrappy. Your mind's going to who picked the kids up? Did the person who was picking them up even get there? It's the dinner. You know, what are we having for dinner? I bet I'm going to walk in that door and someone's going to say, "What's for dinner?" And they know that I've been here all day. And all that stuff's going on in our heads, and that's all right. I can work with that. There's no trouble with that at all. I'm here really representing our team, and in truth, the project is not called Clinical Excellence and Love Project. Wouldn't that be great if it was? But my talk is called Clinical Excellence and Love. The project is the Clinical Excellence Project, and it's a joint initiative between the Office of the Chief Nurse and Midwifery Officer and the Executive Director of Nursing and Midwifery Services from Metro South Health. And it is now coming to the conclusion of its third phase. This phase has been running for 8 months, and it has focused on, that's just a huge blank. It's beautiful. It's focused on making the contribution that nurses and midwives make in the clinical environment, whether that be in, the healthcare environment, so whether that's in the clinical environment, whether that's in management, wherever nurses and midwives find themselves working. This project is about recognising the contribution and the unique contribution that is made. And it does this through two avenues. One is through nursing excellence programs, and the other is through the development of professional practice models. Now, it's really lovely because one of the things that I feel so grateful for is that I have had the opportunity to travel around the state, and I've seen lots of people. I saw Amy this morning, bleary-eyed at I don't know what time it was, standing at the lights out there, and she's walking up to me with a great big smile, and I met her in Roma, and there have been other people that I've seen around the place who, being in this lovely and delightful project, has given me the privilege to learn more about, to understand more about the work that you do, to have a renewed respect for rural and remote nursing and midwifery, and all of the context that we find ourselves practicing nursing and midwifery around the state. I know I've only got 10 minutes, and I did note there's no bell or no gong or no big guy to come and get you. And look at you, he's had it. He's exhausted all his energy this morning, so I don't have to worry about that. I reckon I can take you anyway, so. We do not try that, because you're the sort of guy who's a bit random, I reckon. what I would like to do is, rather than talk about all of that, because there's a whole lot of it, and there is a website that is dedicated to this, and there's also a clinical excellence symposium that's taking place next month, which registration will open in a couple of days, and it'd be great to see you all there. But I would like to talk about the professional practice models and the developing of professional practice models. And if it's okay with you for now, I'll just refer to them as PPMs, because it's just too much. One of the things, the lovely things about developing a PPM for with, and when I say you, because you guys do it, not me, is that it brings nurses and midwives together into a room to talk about themselves and to talk about who they are, about what they do, about who they do that for and with, and to really showcase, highlight, show off, talk about, share, reflect about the contribution and the purpose of nursing and midwifery within a healthcare service. And I have found in doing this work that there's no shortage of talking, because once we all get together, we actually really love to converse, and we shouldn't shy away from that. That is our gift. As nurses and midwives, it's a human-to-human thing that we do, so talking and sharing and being with others and nurturing and practicing that should always, I think, every opportunity, we should take that. So that work in developing the PPMs, our professional practice models consist of a number of things. There's a mission statement, there's a vision statement. There are some core components. We've got the one from the Office of the Chief Nurse here, which is pretty fantastic, and Shelley was delighted this morning to know that I don't know of any other PPM that's made its way to a mat anywhere. So it's pretty fantastic, or it's a whopping big badge for a big guy. But it looks really, really good. So I thought I should stand here near it too, because I'm going to talk about it. But when we are developing PPMs, there's the core components, which are in this model are the clinical excellence, the development and recognition, and they're sort of like the structures and process. But the stuff that I really love is the values. And in this model, the values are sitting around the centre, and if you look up there, you'll see some values in that that arrow that's being shot through that heart with love. So the values are what, for nurses and midwives working in a health service, are the deeply held driving forces. They're the qualities or the traits or the things that we feel so strongly and passionately about in our work that, if you like, we would like to, that they're like our hallmarks. As a nursing and midwifery service, we're saying, this is what we want to be known for. These are the values that we want to put forward and to stand by, to feel proud of, but for to be the hallmarks of our service. So that work is really lovely. And what is up there, you can see through the arrow, it doesn't matter where I've wandered about, whether it's metropolitan, whether it's going out to rural health services, whether that's an addiction and mental health service, whether that's the Office of the Chief Nurse and Midwifery Officer. These seven values keep popping their head up. I haven't put them in any order, but I will tell you that the number one, the most frequently tapped into value, is respect. The others are just in order, but that is, they are the top seven that as I said, that continue to put their hand up. And it's lovely because it says that this is what nurses and midwives around the state hold dear. You can't see this stuff until you actually make it visible. And that's the really important and next step that I just want to share with you, is that this is a fabulous map. If any of you, I work in a service where we've had, it's not a midwifery service, and we've had a professional practice model for nurses for quite some time now. But what I know is that it is just a flat thing. It's a badge, makes a great badge. If you can see it made into a cup, that's sort of cool too. It's now Matt. I absolutely, if Veronica were here, she definitely wanted the QE2s one to be made into earrings. That's sort of sad, but we love her. So there's no end of stuff that you can do with it. But the truth is that unless, I sort of see the values as like a heart. And you have to have those values or that heart beating for this thing to come to life. And it comes to life and it beats through you. Otherwise, it's a one-dimensional thing. It sits on the back of a strategic plan. It's actually really meaningless. So as I travel around, one of the things that I do to get people to talk, and again, because I know that it's such a noble craft, nursing and midwifery, and the noble sciences. The body of knowledge that is with nursing and midwifery, respectively, is unique, and it should be honoured. But one of the things that I do is ask nurses and midwives to think about, why did you become a nurse or a midwife? And then I ask them to have a little conversation with somebody, and then open the room up after a little bit of time, usually dragging people away from the story. and say, would anybody like to share why they became a nurse and a midwife? I'm yet to find any audience that, everybody wants to share. Because even just the very thing of reflecting and thinking about that time, it ignites some love, some passion in their heart. Oh yeah, that's the love, living our values. You got that, hey? Did you get that? That's why I made it different colours. I was really jealous of that guy that had the beating heart. Do you see his heart beating up and think? I thought, oh, I wish I wasn't such a digital idiot. I could have done that. But anyway, that's all right. So to tell this story, and the responses that come back from that story are really varied. And there are some that I won't tell you, because I think that our young man over here has shocked us all enough with, those, oh my God, please tell him he's not going to keep going with that story. But there's a whole range of stuff. But some of them are we're deaf in our family. Well, they're deaf. The afternoon's not over. The stories range from, and remembering that there's a range of ages in the room too, but some of the things that people have said are, I couldn't stand my parents one day longer, and nursing offered the nursing quarters. somebody suggested that there was an opportunity to meet guys, and they liked the look of them in uniforms. These are true. Somebody who was so inspired by the community nurse in Heartbeat. I didn't laugh when they said that, but I was like, it's true. And yet another person who said that they had a desire to help people, and they believed that nursing was the thing that offered them an opportunity to fulfill that desire. But in closing, I just want to tell you a story about a person whose response to that question was, I became a nurse because I was born and lived with a childhood illness, and I had frequent and many hospitalizations all through my growing, and I sort of understood that to be, grade 1 to grade 7, not into high school. And it was because of that I made a decision to become a nurse. And I have reflected on that often and thought, thinking about a child, and I've got a baby, my baby's 29, but I do remember when he was a baby, and I'm thinking about a child. What does a child need? They're not timing how long you take to answer the call bell. They're not timing how long the drip, what it was, I'm a mental health nurse, it goes, that's something. It's not good, but I know there's a button you can turn it off. That's good. So what does a child need to have a dream birthed in their heart? And not just a dream that's birthed in their heart, but they stay inspired. Like, I was a really stupid person at 16. And this person went to uni at 18. So even though all those opportunities to be really dumb and stupid and do silly things, they stayed inspired to be a nurse during that time. And when I think about that and the needs of a child in hospital, they're really basic needs, aren't they? They are to feel loved and cared for, to feel safe, to feel kindness toward them. I was so delighted to hear, was it Peter Gillies this morning talking about kindness? I think it was Mark Twain that said that kindness is the language that the deaf can hear and the blind can see. And I think that this is what this child must have experienced. She must have been in the presence of people who lived their values, that they were full of love. And it's a story that, as I say, has touched my heart, because I think that it is the potential that is within each and every one of us. And 16 of the 17 health services, 15 of the 16 health services have taken up this offer through the project. And so you will be, some of you, developing your professional practice models. And I encourage you to take hold of the love aspect of this, to live our values, because I honestly believe that clinical excellence can thrive in the presence of love. There's all that other stuff, but everything that we do, if it is infused with the values that we say that we hold dear, with honesty, with kindness, with integrity, respect, compassion, trust, and collaboration. If all of those things that come together, then the people that are in the environment that actually really matter, that's the people receiving care, then they will experience not only your love, but clinical excellence. So thank you.
Great time for us to work on building our PPM in Ocamo, and we appreciated the facilitation that we received, and we're very happy with it and very, very proud of it. Okay, we'll move on if there's no questions.